Okay, so I'm a biomedical engineer with passion for tissue engineering, and I will talk today about this, about the concept of tissue engineering, which I believe may indeed change our lives in a very substantial way. Let me give you a couple of reasons why we are so interested in tissue engineering. One fact is that we live longer and we would like to live better in these days. And if this is going to happen, then we really need spare parts to maintain our bodies. It is pretty much like maintaining a car. If something breaks, you would repair it or replace it, and then you run longer, and then you repair the next piece, and then you run a little bit longer again. The other reason is that actually tissue engineering can also foster biological and medical research and help therapies that go way beyond replacement of the body parts. So the humankind has had this eternal idea of staying forever young, which is so nicely depicted in this famous picture, The Fountain of Youth, of Luca Cranach. And what you see here is that elderly and ailing are coming into the Fountain of Youth at one end, and then at the other end, they are exiting as young and healthy people. So we are not there yet. There is no such thing as the Fountain of Youth. But actually, something very interesting is happening. Here are some numbers that are most helpful. One is that out of all people who ever made it to age 65, two-thirds are alive today. So living longer than 50 or 60 is actually a very new phenomenon. And if you look into the life expectancy, if you start from classical Greece, which means 5 centuries BC, the life expectancy was about 28 years. And as you go through history, you come pretty much with the same number of 28 or 30 years all the way to the 20th century. And then things started to change. So today, in 2010, the world average is about 67 years old, and the developed world average that I illustrate by just using number for the USA is 78 years. So it practically tripled in about 100 years or so. So things are happening in this direction. As a result of the need to have better treatments for maintaining human body, 20 years ago in 1989, Life magazine was running a story entitled Replaceably You, and they interviewed the scientific community. They looked for scientists and engineers and clinicians, and they asked them, okay, what are our options? What do we have to repair our damaged or missing skin or bones or heart muscle or anything else? And the collective answer of the scientific community is actually shown here with this Robocop. So what you can appreciate is that absolutely everything in this image is artificial. So the idea in only 20 years ago in 1989 was that yes, we do have some options, but these options are actually spare parts that are made out of ceramics and titanium and wires and plastics and other artificial materials. Interestingly, only 10 years later, another magazine, Time magazine, was running a very similar story. They were looking into what changed. And they asked the same question, pretty much the same community of people around the world, and they got a strikingly different answer. What you see here is that this envisioned Robocop was actually made out of totally biological materials. It doesn't mean that in 1999 there was an ability of scientific community to make a bionic human, to replace human body parts by biological substitutes. But what really happened was that science and engineering and medicine integrated in a way and the mindset changed. And there was this vision that actually our spare parts will be biological and not non-biological spare parts. So this is a nice statement that I think illustrates what tissue engineering may be doing for us. Tissue engineering is a way to make tissues and organs that people need to repair their bodies. I'll just read it to you. The development of agriculture freed humanity from reliance on what nature was kind enough to provide. This was long ago, as you know, in Neolithic. The development of tissue engineering should provide analogous freedom from the limitations of the human body. So this is, again, the same year, so this would be just about the same year as this bionic human that I showed you. So how do we do that? How can we possibly make a piece of human tissue starting from scratch? The logic is actually very simple. We talk about tissue engineering, we talk about tissue engineers, and in all reality, the only tissue engineer is the living cell. So only cells can make tissues. And what we do in our field is actually to design the environments for the cells to do their job. So it's very simple. The difficulty comes with the fact that there are so many factors that determine what the cell will be doing. So if you look into a living cell, it will respond to entire context of its environment. It will respond to molecules that we call cytokines because they're affecting the cells. It will talk to other cells. There is always this conversation between the two cells that live in the same area. It will interact with the extracellular matrix, and it will also respond to physical forces. We have hydrodynamic flow forces, mechanical forces, electrical forces in our body. So all this will actually affect the gene apparatus in the cell, and there may be very different outcomes depending on what these signals are and how they interact with each other. On the other hand, the process goes in the other direction. So the cells will also secrete molecules and affect the other cells and make or break extracellular matrix and generate mechanical forces. So there is this very complex dynamic interplay between the cells and their environment that really determines what is going to happen at the end. So we need to be careful about what are the exact conditions that we are providing to the cells when we are intending to make tissues, and the outcomes will definitely depend on what we do. But the principle is that we should really try to be as native-like or biomimetic as humanly possible. When you look into this picture that describes the cell culture and tissue culture for, say, 150 or so years, you see a Petri dish invented by Julius Petri, who was Robert Koch's assistant, and he made these dishes so that they could study tuberculosis. This was inherited by the biological community, and then you place the cells into the Petri dish, and you look into them, and you study them. Development of biology really happened with this Petri dish, but in many cases, it's very limiting. If you just look into the physical situation, the cell is attached to the substrate with about one half of its surface area, outer area, and bathing in a culture medium with the other half of its surface area, and waiting for someone to change this medium every now and then, which usually happens every 2 or 3 days. If you look here into the actual situation in vivo, this is one cell, this is another cell, here is some collagen, here are some blood vessels, here is a beautifully developed vasculature, you can appreciate the huge complexity of our body. So the cells are, as someone said, homesick when they're in this kind of environment, and we are trying to place them into this kind of environment if you're going to get predictable answers to our questions. And this is where cultural environments come into the place. This is where engineering starts to work with biology hand in hand, because you really want to have environmental control and you want to subject the cells to all these factors, not only some of the molecules, so that you can induce them to do their job. So once you lift your recipes from the book of biology and you say, okay, this is what we are going to do, this is what we really need to do to make, for example, a piece of heart muscle or a piece of bone, because this is what happens during development, then things become very simple. So the overall concept of tissue engineering is remarkably simple because it only involves three components. You have the cells that are totally at the center of this world, and then you have two other components that are at their service. You have what we call scaffolding material because it has the same function as scaffolding for the building. So you have material that is designed to mimic extracellular matrix in our body that provides a template for the cells to attach to and to have this conversation, to recognize molecules, to experience physical forces, to see architecture of the material that they recognize. And obviously, this will be very different for different tissues. So this is one important source of information, not only a home for the cells to make a tissue. And then you have the other component that we call bioreactor. This is a culture environment. So this would be a substitute body. Here, cells obtain everything else. This is where you give them the right temperature, the right pH, the right molecules. You can stretch them mechanically. You can excite them electrically. You give them everything they need to thrive. The result of this are pieces of tissue, and I'll show you two examples only today. You can make a little piece of heart tissue that you can study for a repair of infarcted heart, or you can make a piece of bone tissue that you can study again for the repair of bone. Very importantly, the product of this process is not only a piece of tissue, it is a knowledge. You understand better under controllable conditions that are similar to those in our body how things work, and you can devise other ways to regenerate tissue in the body, for example, by inducing regeneration by using other means. So one example that I mentioned is cardiac muscle. So what you see here is actually heart, human heart after infarction. You see this dark area, so this is a dead muscle because of the stop of blood flow, and this muscle will never ever regenerate. So what we are thinking about is growing pieces of the heart tissue that would serve as a band-aid that you would place over this area here to help heal and regenerate and recover function. Another example is engineering of a bone. There are many situations when people need a piece of bone, most critically in the area of head and face. It may be because of the surgery that when doctor had to remove a piece of bone for other reason. It may be a result of trauma, something big is broken and it will never regenerate, or it may be that someone is just born without an important piece of bone, and as you may imagine, the damage is not only physical and functional, the damage is also largely psychological. So we thought about making anatomical pieces of living human bone that can be used for these reconstructions that are actually much, much more frequent than you would imagine. So the idea is, again, very simple. So you take medical images and then you feed your computer with digitized files, and then you feed a machine that will make scaffolding material in the exact shape of the graft that you want to make. And then you also make this chamber of the bioreactor as a negative of the graft. So it is a sort of hugging this scaffold that you load with cells and enabling cultivation. You get the cells, you can get them from the patient, for example, from the fat tissue or another source. You put cells into the scaffold in the bioreactor, and after a period of time, you get a piece of bone. So here is how this smart bioreactor looks. It's very small, it's very well working. And using this bioreactor, we actually specifically designed it to make this little piece of human bone. So this is what you have right here. This is the only loaded bone in your head, and it was made exactly to fit to mimic the bone of a specific patient that we have imaged. So how will it work in patients? I will show you a movie. This is a vision, we are not there yet. So you would prepare the cells, which means that you will expand the cells to the numbers that you need, depending on the size of the bone. These are some happy cells that grow in culture. You would take images of the patient to define the defect. In this particular case, it was this temporomandibular joint. You would make the scaffolding material, define the culture conditions, place it into the bioreactor that I showed you, 1, 2, 3, 4, this is the system, and you would culture these grafts until they are ready. You would check them after about a month. And in this particular case, we also look not only for bone, but for vasculature. And then it would eventually go into the patient to replace the missing or broken piece of bone. So let me tell you at the end where I think the field is going. I believe that two main drivers of the progress are collaboration. I will show you this first, and then another one. Things started to change in 1990s when these three communities got under the same roof. So you have clinicians that tell us where the needs are. They bring the sense of reality in terms of needs, what's really necessary, and they also bring the sense of reality about the constraints. What are the things that you should and should not do for one or another reason? There are biologists that help us understand what are the actual factors that would lead to tissue development or regeneration. So this is where we lift our recipes. There is no other way but to actually learn from actual development. And there are engineers that are educated to build and design, and they build models that can be used to engineer tissues, and they build tools that help in this effort, and they also help in seeing, in getting insights into what's happening. Why is this important beyond practical in a philosophical sense? It is really important because this kind of collaboration that's multidisciplinary, that goes across boundary of your own discipline, really helps you learn more. Because bioengineers who are my colleagues, they pretty much know things I know. So to learn more, to go further, to get further, you really need to talk to people who are outside your area of expertise. And the other equally important driver, this is the young talent. So these are the people who are today training as students, as postdocs. They're important for at least two reasons. One reason is they're going to be around for a long time. They will be working in the field for the next 50 years, and they're shaping the future. And the other very important thing is they know a little bit less than we do, which makes them much more brave and much more creative. And this is actually how the field is progressing, not following some of the algorithms that have been already developed long ago. And because TED is really about ideas and predictions, I decided to take my crystal ball and then look into what will happen into the next 20 years. What I described to you was the first 20 years. I believe that over the next 20 years, we will have more and more biological spare parts to repair and maintain our body. I think that we will have methods for inducing regeneration of the tissues and organs inside the body, so one would feed the other and help us have better medicine. Engineered tissues are also serving as platforms for the study of disease and drug development. So tissue engineering will most likely help develop new modalities for the prevention and therapy of some of the major diseases. And I personally believe that actually medicine will become more and more personalized because we are not all made to the same measure. Our body parts have different dimensions. Our metabolism has different rate. So personalizing therapy to every single individual human being is, I think, one very important direction of where we go. This will be achieved by convergence of disciplines, so the whole community working hand in hand together. And I think the end result of this will be that we will be living even longer and even better than we do today. So thank you very much. I'm really delighted to be here today.